Ice Chili, what up? All right, folks. We like to kick off this little bullpen banter show. I guess we should do a little rundown thing. Folks, TG Lowerman, a.k.a. ThatSportsGamer here. My man Millennium on the other end of the mic.
What's going on, guys? Heartbroken from a terrible, terrible loss. So,
with your Sacramento Kings?
Yes, the Sacramento Kings.
And what team is Kobe on in that?
Kobe's on the Mavericks. It's my second year. So the Lakers completely rebuilt in their in the offseason. So D'Angelo Russell is pretty much the center of that team now. So the entire team, the entire Mavericks team is now, it's Kobe, Dwight Howard, Dirk Nowitzki, Chandler Parsons, and J.J. Barea. I was like, the first time I played him that season, I was like, this is not going to go well. And Kobe killed me then, too.
It's not good. It's not good.
Yeah.
Shout out to C. Blake in the chat. Guys, I'm very excited to be talking about MLB The Show tonight with you guys. As you can hear, my voice sounds great. I have an upper respiratory infection.
Oh, not good.
I got them pills that are supposed to help that. I need to take one in like an hour. So if someone can just put a little reminder at 11 p.m. to remind me to take a pill, that'd be great. Last week we talked about Battle Royale strats. I quickly lost with that team that we used, that we made. Then I made another team where I focused on starting pitching.
Mm-hmm.
That went a little bit better. A lot of silver starters.
And I think a lot of that is so you focus on starting pitching. I think you and I both have the same kind of outlook when it comes to that, is that you can – you can work with a starting pitcher for, you know, 2 to 3 innings. I mean, I'll even take an at bat from him if he's doing well. Whereas the bullpen, you know, you're kind of hit or miss. It's like real life. I think the show mimics real life in that when you got put a guy in the bullpen, he might not be hot that day. He might be hot or cold. So not just the inside edge, like he just might not get a feel for him that day. And then in Battle Royale, you only get 2 chances. So,
yeah. And, the only problem was I felt when I went with a little more starting pitching heavy, I didn't have any like great guys off the bench, which was kind of a problem for me.
Right.
Though I was able to hit 2 inside the park home runs in the same game with Dave Winfield and Jordan Schaefer, so that was pretty awesome.
Jordan Schaefer, the budgetist of budget baller center fielders.
Yeah, you can check youtube.com/thatsportsgamer to see that that video of the two of them hitting inside the park home runs. Took Jordan Schaefer 13 seconds to get around the bases. Pretty quick.
And to be fair, you love playing in huge ballparks.
You know, I did not realize that park was that big until like a couple days later when I went and looked at the real dimensions of which field is it? It's
Capital. Capital was one of them you played in, but that's not the one you hit the 2 home runs in.
No, I was playing at one of those historic stadiums whose name I don't remember. I believe it was Forbes. Which one is the one I like? Forbes Field is where I did it. Sometimes I do it at Crosley and stuff, but I don't like Crosley anymore. I'm over that.
Nice. Okay.
So we might just sell that.
But, we saw what you've done. Anything else? Have you gotten any new hotness on the team this week?
Not that I can think of, unless you're thinking of something that I don't remember.
No, I'm not thinking anything specific. I know you already had the hotness that everyone wants that we're going to talk about in the Captain's Tour segment, but I'll tell you what.
I mean, I don't have that guy, so I don't know what you're talking about.
I thought you had that guy.
No, I had that guy last year and loved him so much.
Oh, you need to get that guy.
I need to get that guy. I'm actually right now, the main thing I'm focusing on is getting tickets, which kind of works in for this. I'm working on getting tickets for Rizzo, but it's kind of in a roundabout way because he needs the NL Central guys. I'm actually working on doing the mission for the Cardinals just because I had a bunch of that done already. So I've been playing with a pretty Cardinals-centric team at the moment.
Nice.
Oh, that is one thing I did finish. Who did I finish? Someone? I finished the Cubs and I got Ernie Banks.
Oh, nice. How are you enjoying Mr. Baseball?
Man, you know, Corey Seager plays. What are you talking about?
Corey Seager over Ernie Banks.
I barely play Ernie Banks. It's pretty hilarious.
I just finished Josh Donaldson, that store, which is funny because he was level 20 when I could actually access the store. And I moved immediately over to Altuve, and Hosmer's finished. Now Donaldson's done, and I'm going to work on DeGrom instead of Rizzo, because there's no chance I'm getting 30 levels of Rizzo done in 1 week. Although we do have a mutual acquaintance that's trying to do that. More best of luck to him.
I remember trying to do Rizzo in a week like 3 weeks ago, and I'm still at level 27.
Yeah, exactly. That's the thing. You get to like level 25, and then it just slows down so much. So my idea is, okay, so they've done, what was it, Hosmer? Altuve was one, because that's when I tried to do Altuve. Then Hosmer got a good one. I think he got the Syndergaard, right? Or something like that. So my idea is I'm going to get DeGrom done, and I will then have four of the guys and two of them that haven't had a diamond or high gold yet, and hopefully that'll be the one.
You know, we might as well trash the rundown, and we can just talk about the captain store right now if you want.
I would love to talk about the captain store right now.
We're looking at the Josh Donaldson one at the moment. Odubel Herrera is the rank 20, and Chris Davis is the rank 30. I don't like Chris Davis.
I like him because I'm a homer, but his contact, I think you and I, again, something we both agree on is power is nice in this game, but this game is built on contact and vision.
Yep.
When you're playing Battle Royale and Diamond Dynasty, I think it's not, like I said, nice to have a power guy, but if he leaves guys on base, it's not like you're going to get that chance to hit 40 home runs over 160 game season. Franchise is different, but Diamond Dynasty, where it's one game at a time, I think Chris Davis is not the first baseman you want.
Yeah. As I've always said, if you have contact, it will breed power, but power will not breed contact.
Agreed. But that Odubel Herrera, though, I think we also both agree that card is not even, it's not even stealth beast anymore. It's straight beast.
Yep.
Because of his contact numbers.
Yeah, 86 contact versus righties, 82 against lefties, 82 speed, 78 mm-hmm. clutch. Very, very nice looking card.
That clutch is always so undervalued, too. I don't know why people don't go after that more often. Again, especially, and we're going to talk about Battle Royale, but Diamond Dynasty games, Odubel Herrera, you put him in the 9-hole, he gets, or the 8-hole, and he gets up with guys on base, that's going to up his value for you. It's going to make him better in those clutch situations.
Next up, going to the DeGrom store, we got Matt Shoemaker as the rank 20, and Yoenis Cespedes as the rank 30. I'm actually thinking about getting the Cespedes, but I need to look at how he's doing in real life before I actually make
jump
a final decision
on that bandwagon.
Yeah.
Yeah, again, another guy with really huge power numbers and decent contact, better than the Davis. 82 clutch, I love. The fielding and the arm strength take him from a really good center fielder to elite level fielding in right field. So a guy with 98 arm strength, 88 arm accuracy that you can put in right field pretty much anywhere and control that running game.
Yeah, and the nice thing is he has center field by default, which apparently, like, not a lot of my favorite center fielders have center field by default anymore. Like Mookie Betts has moved to right.
Right.
So Giannis is a nice guy to have out there. 98 arm strength, as you said, is just great. Who are we looking at that had 99 arm strength for, like, no apparent reason? Was it Hazel Baker or someone?
Somebody like that had, like, a really sick arm strength, and I'm not sure. We couldn't figure out why. You know what? Let me look at that real quick. Well, go on to the next store, and I'll come back for that.
Next door is Jose Altuve. Rank 20 is Jose Iglesias, and rank 30 is Ken Giles. I don't know why Ken Giles is a rank 30 reward.
This is the second week in a row. Rank, yeah, like I think again, for the first month or so, I think these have been, or 2 months, these have been planned out to where they're going to go. Obviously, because the Rizzo is a diamond, and they're not just going to throw diamonds in the store all the time. So, I mean, it makes sense under the Rizzo, but yeah, I don't think either one of those is going to be worth. I like Iglesias a lot, especially with his fielding. If you're looking for a budget guy in terms of high contact, high vision, if I remember correctly, and really good fielding, decent arm strength.
Yeah. If you play that Corey Seager, just have Jose Iglesias on the bench just in case.
Exactly. Yeah, something like that. So
next up, the Anthony Rizzo store, which has Rank 20, Mike Leake, good pitcher. Maybe we talk about him later. I don't know if I haven't checked your list. He has a nice windup, I'll tell you that much.
Yeah, very deceptive windup. Like his pitches, too. His pitch mix is, I think, sinker, cutter, curveball, circle, chain. Oh, is it chain slider? Okay. Yeah, and good break on everything. His sinker is really hard to hit when you match it up with his slider. They look very similar coming out of his hand, out of his arm slot.
And then
and the Rizzo is just, I mean, do we even really need to talk about that? Yeah.
Rizzo wasn't the player I played best with last year, so I probably should get this at some point. But I have that Jose Abreu, and I have Adrian Gonzalez, who kind of like combined to be Anthony Rizzo, though he has 51 speed, which I think is faster than both of them. But 77 vision, that's huge. 77 clutch.
Yeah.
If you can get yourself an Anthony Rizzo, go get yourself an Anthony Rizzo. This has been the most expensive card we've seen in ticket-wise, right?
Ticket-wise,
$2,300?
Yeah, absolutely. Yep. Right now, inside edge up to a 99. The other thing, again, you know I always harp on, 82 fielding. Really good for first baseman. You get that corner infield animation where the line drive goes by you. That doesn't happen to Rizzo that often.
Yeah, it happens to Abreu all the time. Quite frustrating. Next up, who's this, Eric Hosmer?
Yes, the Hosmer story, yes.
Rank 20 is Michael Pineda. And rank 30 is Corey Kluber.
I think the Pineda is a sneaky good card, but you can get it on the cheap on the store. Yeah. Why waste 325 tickets on it?
I think you can spend less than 325 stubs and probably get it.
Yeah. Same thing with the Kluber. I don't think the Kluber is that expensive. I think most of the Kluber cost comes out of him being one of the top cards in the Indians collection.
Yep.
So, but again, I like guys with completely different from our guest last week. I like sinker slider guys in this game. Paul, I know Paul Sporer said, was not a big fan of like two seamers, not a big fan of sinkers in general in this game. I, on the other hand, love throwing that low end two seamer, low end sinker, and just getting guys just beat the ball onto the ground.
Yeah, it looks like you can get Kluber for about $6,000.
$6,000 as opposed to 950 tickets. But the problem is then you get a guy like Rizzo comes up for 2,300 tickets and you don't have any. So, yeah, I agree. Probably better just use your stubs on him.
Yep. Going to the David Ortiz store, rank 20 is Tyson Ross, and rank 30 is Cole Hamels. Also, rank 10 showing from Jorge De La Rosa.
Whoa.
It's not terrible.
Windup.
Terrible windup for the game, but...
Yeah. I like the Hamels a lot. I think we talked about that was one of the cards I purchased recently. The Hamels and the Dallas Keuchel.
Mm-hmm. I just picked up Hamels and Yu Darvish because I finished the Rangers set.
Nice. Yeah, that Cole Hamels, his fastball combination with a circle change with very good break on it almost makes it look like a slow two-seamer. So he has a fastball, a circle and a two-seamer that look exactly the same except for speed, and then a sweeping curve that is so slow but so good. All his pitches play well off of each other.
Yeah, I used him in a couple Diamond Dynasty games, and I liked what I saw out of him.
So. I use his windup in my Road to the Show pitcher. Love his windup.
I think that might be a little bit too much for me. That might be a little bit too much Cole Atlas for me. So next up, we are going to talk... Well, we should take a little pause for a second, so it makes it easier for me to cut later. So we're going to talk about my Twitter, apparently, because I have the wrong page pulled up. All right, so we're going to talk about... Relax, buddy. All right, so we're going to talk about the 5-12 roster update. Came out a little early this week.
On a Thursday instead of a Friday, right?
They just started switching to Fridays, and they drop one on a Thursday. I mean, I don't know what's going on here.
Hey, you know what? Let them put it out whenever, as long as it comes out once a week. I don't care when it comes out.
Yeah, but then it makes the show on a Monday seem a little dated because it's going to get changed in a couple days.
No.
It was better when this
was
like fresh and new. But now
it's always fresh and new, TJ.
But now we've had time to digest it, which is nice.
Yeah, and one of the – I think some of the big changes, the big bumps, you know, the Yelich card, Rizzo going up a spot.
A lot of silvers became golds this week.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, Rondon. How many? Rondon, Fowler, Quintana, Odor, all became gold this week.
Odor, nice little bump in the right-handed power from 62 to 70. Wonder why?
Yeah. Got a mean right hook.
Yep, he does.
I had a couple guys in this that I wanted to call out, if you don't mind.
Go for it.
Number one, the Robinson Cano. Got a nice bump to contact versus righties. Obviously, not really a budget play. But if you had him on your bench and you were kind of not super happy with him, it might be worth going back to check out because he got +8 to his contact versus righties. And what was it? +19 to his power versus righties.
Yes.
As well as a 8-point bump to his vision, bringing him up to 70. He's going to be pretty, pretty nasty. Only thing, he actually took a almost 20-point drop in his discipline, which kind of sucks, but...
Yeah, but discipline, at the very least, for online, discipline's not going to affect too much in terms of playing other users, thankfully.
Yep.
But that being said, what I found funny was a lot of people bought the Cano before the roster update, and then everybody sold him the morning of, and his price went down. Like, if that's another thing, playing the market, always be on the lookout around roster update time for prices to jump and drop for no reason.
I was trying to get him for like $9,000 last Monday.
Yep.
And I think I had like a high buy, and now he's just skyrocketed since then.
Yep.
With that little roller coaster that he took in the middle. Actually, I can't see it on the screen, but it's all right. Next guy I wanted to point out was, as you said, Christian Yelich.
Yes.
He gets his contact bumped up to 90 versus righties, 76 versus lefties. 10-point bump to his power versus righty, bringing up to 52. Still not great. But when you have 90 contact versus righties, contact, as we said, contact breeds power.
Absolutely. Won't hurt you in the field. Actually really good in the field. Decent speed. His steal rating up to a 51 makes him a perfect, possibly, two-hitter for you.
Yeah.
His contact being as high as it is, it allows you to do a little bit with left and right, being able to go opposite way for you. So definitely a perfect two-hitter behind a fast guy like a Crawford or our Ichiro.
Next up, we got Brandon Belt. He got a nice bump to his contact versus righties, bringing him up to an 83. A little bit of a bump to his power, +2 to his power versus righties, but a +11 to his power versus lefties, bringing him up to a 67. I think I was using him is there a flashback version of him? No, I think I was just using him in a Battle Royale. And he was a pretty nice card. Actually, I liked hitting with him.
I appreciate you updating your pronunciation of Royale.
I don't like it, but...
No, you don't. That's why I appreciate it. And pretty soon, we're going to be having That Sports Gamer playing Battle Royale with cheese.
No. Next up, a guy that we've been talking about, and if you're working on a budget team, definitely go out and get Steven Piscotty.
Oh, yes. And again, our guest last week, Paul Sporer, talked about him. Great hitter against lefties and righties.
Yep.
Has above average power against both. 79 contact versus righties, 82 versus lefties, 77 clutch, and will not hurt you in the field. You can put him in either corner outfield spot, and in a pinch, you can put him at first base.
They even give him a secondary position of center field, too, which is nice.
Yes, and the other part of this is he's not done rising. He's still tearing the cover off the ball in real life. So,
and the last one, remember when we said contact breeds power? Throw that completely out the window. Bringing up my boy, Chris Carter, who I love. He got a 4-point bump this week. He gained 7 to his contact versus righty, bringing up to a monster 49.
Yes.
His power versus righty went up to 93. Power versus lefty up to 88. So if you want to just take a you want to just take 26 vision, so you're probably not hitting anything. But if you want to take a chance on a righty bat off the bench for 300, and you can probably get him for 350, Chris Carter's your play.
Anyone that wants to go to my Twitter page, this man, I will never question this man again. A few days ago, I had a Battle Royale game where I had a home run robbery in the fourth inning. In the bottom of the fourth, it was Chris Carter bomb, and then lefty. Chris Davis. And then Chris Davis, another high power, lower contact guy. Bombs all over the place. Just bombs walking off. It was great. I'll never question him again.
I did my true 162 2 years ago now. Chris Carter was my first baseman /DH, and he just, like, wrecked house. He hit, like, 230, but I think he hit, like, 48 home runs.
Yep.
Shorb63 in the chat wants to know, what's a good threshold for clutch?
Good threshold for clutch. You want to look at something over 75 for a major upgrade. Anything over 60 gets an up. I think it's 60 that gets the upgrade. But 75 is where you start really noticing guys on base. And just so you know, clutch has twofold. Clutch will help you when you have runners on in scoring position, but it also helps you in the seventh, eighth, and ninth inning. In Battle Royale, the way I understand it is it will help you in the third inning or the third inning further. So take everything in a regular nine-inning game and divide by three, obviously. So if you have a high clutch guy, not a bad idea that if you have he's a decent hitter, but high clutch is his main rating for you, maybe throw him in the bottom three of your lineup and try to get him on base that way.
Excellent. Yeah, I need to focus more on clutch. I don't think I do, and I feel like that might be hindering me a little bit.
You still have to have the ratings to hit. Like, if you have a clutch guy that's got 30 contact, he's still going to be a 30 contact guy, but you'd be surprised how often you go, wow, that guy really just got a great hit from me, and then realize his clutch is like 80.
Right. So I feel like we're doing a great job tonight. We're flying through things. We're knocking off topics one by one. So now it's time to get to the meat of tonight's show. We're going to talk about some budget starting pitchers. How do you want to do this? Want to go 1-1-1-1?
Yeah, let's go back and forth. I think we both have just about the same amount of numbers. I know you want to talk about the flashbacks, too. Mm-hmm. Leave the flashbacks.
Your number three guy is not the flashback version, correct?
No, that is the straight version.
Okay. So I'm looking at the market right now of the starting pitchers. I mean, if you really want to go out and spend, it's going to cost you at least 70 to get Clayton Kershaw. I mean, that's something you can do. These are, I believe, all guys that are going to cost you less than 1,000 stubs.
Yes.
And
in most cases, much less than that.
The first one that I am going to recommend you take a look at is the Angels' Garrett Richards, currently going for a buy now of 415, sell now of 250.
Right.
He's got a four-seam slider, two-seam cutter, and curveball. This guy's nasty. You know what I'm going to do right now? I'm going to do something I don't like to do a lot. I'm going to come out here. I'm going to go to my statistics. I'm going to go to starting pitchers. Where is this guy here? Who am I talking about?
Garrett Richards.
Look at this. He's pitched five games for me, all right? One at bat. Mm-hmm. What happened to that at bat? I think we know what happened to that at bat.
There's no way. Huh? So I want to talk about his at bat.
He got a strikeout. I guess that other Garrett Richards home run was something else. Only eight innings because I used him in a bunch of BR games. I really hate the stats page. Oh, great. It doesn't even have pitching stats on the starting pitcher thing. Excellent. Love this game.
Flip the stats. I think you can flip over. You're looking at batting stats, maybe?
No, I was on the starting pitcher one, and of course, it doesn't let me see it there.
No, you're looking at the pitcher, but I think you have to actually switch it to.
What does that even mean?
Yeah, they're going pitchers. No, there's ways to look at batting stats and ways to look at pitching stats, I believe.
That's a terrible idea.
I'm not saying the design's great. I'm just telling you that's the way it works.
Boom. Garrett Richards, 5-0 with him. Dude's a beast.
Yes.
Love him so much. I've let up two runs with him. I haven't pitched a ton of innings with him because I've been playing, I've used him mainly in Battle Royale. But I love him. If you have 250 stubs to spend, go get yourself Garrett Richards.
And who doesn't have 250 stubs to spend?
I mean, everybody should.
Yeah. So, and the big thing about the Garrett Richards, you're going to look at the stats, is he's got a 97-mile-an-hour fastball, a 95-mile-an-hour two-seamer, a 95-mile-an-hour cutter, but here's where you really want to start looking at stuff. So his cutter has an 84 control. He has better control over his cutter than he does his four-seamer, two-seamer. Always remember what your control ratings are. They have something to do with when you hit your spot, how close to the spot the pitch goes. So slider, 81 control, cutter, 84 control. Pro tip is his curveball, though. Even though it's his fifth pitch, he's only got 38 control over it. 78 miles an hour up against that four-seam of 97 and 93 break.
It's funny that you mentioned that. Because who is the one pitcher you know that I never want to use? mainly because I faced him a million times online.
The one guy.
I love when they bring him in because I always crush him. But I don't like to have him.
Oh,
I'm
during the day. No, or Neshek. Close. Or Neshek. Yes.
Neshek.
One of those guys.
Pat Neshek?
Neshek, yes.
I was watching the Astros game a couple nights ago. I think he threw like a 91 mile per hour fastball and like a 68 mile per hour curveball. Or not curveball, changeup. And then right. I thought, I think I need some Pat Neshek on my team.
Oh, I know.
I'm going to start using him now.
The pitch speed differential is something I've been starting to use a lot more on my team, looking at it. And one of the guys that's not going to be on this list, but should be because of his knuckleball, is Steven Wright. Mm-hmm. I didn't even think about this at the time.
Nasty guy.
Wright throws an 88, 89 mile an hour four-seamer.
Yeah.
As opposed to his 70 mile an hour knuckleball. I mean, knuckleballers are hard enough to hit as it is, but when you include a 20 mile an hour jump on a fastball, insane. So again, you're not going to hear him on this list, but Steven Wright, Boston Red Sox knuckleballer, somebody you could look on, throw in your rotation, and really screw with people online.
Yeah, I forget. I know there was someone I was looking at. I'm like, oh, this guy's kind of good. And then I realized he had like no differentiation. Actually, you know what? It is the next guy that I'm going to bring up. I did put him on the list, but he doesn't have that big of a differentiation, and I'm kind of upset about it.
Yeah, they're still working on it. I think the pitch effects data is still coming in.
But let's go to your next guy, and I'm going to have to try to remember what team he's on now.
He is on the Astros right now.
The Astros.
Yes. Sure. Not pitching very well. Has actually had a couple of downgrades recently, I believe. So the reason I'm going to bring him up, and this is going to be Doug Fister, right-hander for the Houston Astros.
Currently going for 279, 190.
Correct.
It's a great sweep right there.
Easy pickup for you. Not great in terms of hits over nine or Ks over nine, but that's not what you're looking for on this. You're looking for his home runs over nine, especially in Battle Royale, and his walks over nine. So walks over nine is something that will help you. It makes the actual mechanic of pitching easier to hit the line. For meter pitching, easier to hit the line. For analog pitching, easier to hit the line on the way down. For pulse pitching, it keeps your pulse smaller and slower. But
this is what you've learned from all your testing?
Yes. Oh, God. Too much testing. But here's what you like about Doug Fister, and you have to be crafty to use him, which most people can. Sinker, two-seamer, cutter, curve, change. Everything he throws moves. Everything he throws is... He's a junk baller. He's a right-handed junk baller, but with great control. 91 control on his sinker, 93 control on his two-seamer, 96 control on his changeup. And even on his fourth and fifth pitches, 62 and 73 on his cutter and curveball. Everything you throw is going to go where you throw it. It's going to go. You're not going to get any, oh, my God, I just threw this ball over the middle of the plate. You can pick corners with this guy. You can frustrate people with his sinker. Again, good defense behind you. Get yourself a Doug Fister. You just ground balls all day.
Yeah, he's kind of – I mean, we talked about Corey Kluber in the captain sets or the captain store. Doug Fister's kind of like the real cheap version of Corey Kluber.
Absolutely.
The only real big difference is Kluber's got a slider, Fister's got a cutter.
Right.
And Kluber's got a four-seam and Fister's got a two-seam. Other than that, they have the same makeup. They have the same kind of delivery. They're very close to each other.
Yep. And the thing you always, like I said, again, you want to remember when it comes to this is you have to have a pretty good defense behind you. So if you've got, you know, Andrels and Simmons behind you, I'm trying to think of a good budget second baseman right off the top of my head that's good fielding. Probably like a Jonathan Scope, maybe.
I want to say Lindor is still not super expensive.
He just got bumped to gold, so he took a rise. But you're right, still not crazy expensive. Yeah. The other thing I wanted to mention about your guy, Garrett Richards, before we get off of it too much, Garrett Richards, because he's hurt, not going to be doing too much up or down. So he's pretty much going to
sometimes that's right nice.
Exactly, absolutely, especially with the way the Angels are playing right now.
Next up, I am going to go with a man from Tampa Bay, which this is in like order of the teams as it is in the other screens, not alphabetically. Sometimes very right. confusing. I'm going to go with Jake Odorizzi.
Odorizzi, yep.
Four seam, split, two seam, cut, slider. He throws everything hard. That's going to be my main knock against him. His fastball is like 91, or his fastballs are 91, and his slider being as low as pitch is an 82. So, I mean, with him, you're going to have to really mix up location because you're not going to be working like fast slow. So he's going to be a little bit more difficult to pitch with, but still a very good pickup. Good control on everything, really, except for the cutter and the slider a little bit. But he's definitely worth taking a look at.
And the thing I really like about Odorizzi is, so you mentioned that he throws everything hard. Well, when you get into a split finger pitcher, a guy without a true change, another guy like this is Kevin Gausman. Throws four seam, two seam, and splitter out of the hand in this game. All four, and even the cutter for that matter, all four of those pitches look exactly the same. You can't tell until the very, like I would say, probably last 20 feet in game. And you get a high break on a two seamer, like a 76, like he has. Again, it's a pitch to contact guy. He's not a strikeout guy, even though he's got a 69 K over nine. He is going to be somebody you look at in terms of throwing his fastball, establishing both fastballs first, coming back and using the splitter to get guys to swing over top.
And for your next pick, we're actually going to stick with the Rays.
Yes.
And go to Alex Cobb.
Love this guy.
Currently at 290, 190 right now.
Yes, absolutely love this guy, specifically because of his changeup. He has one of the best non-circle changeups in the game. I will warn that his windup is a little wonky. He has a leg on his leg kick. He has a pause. So if that bothers you, don't bother with Alex Cobb. But his two-seamer changeup, you can, again, guys that have pitches that look the same out of the hand, his windup specifically coming through. But that changeup, you throw it low. I've seen people just nonstop swing over top of it.
I like me an Alex Cobb.
Yep.
Next one is a guy I got early and kind of love him. Cliff Lee off the free agent pile, even though he's actually retired, I believe. 535, 330 as of this recording. 98 stamina, which is nice.
Yes.
85 break, 88 walks per nine. He's got a two-seamer, a cutter, a four-seamer, a circle change, and the slow curve. I like the mix of pitches. Got something breaking every which way but loose.
Yep.
And he's just one of those crafty lefties. He just seems to get guys out in this game.
And again, his sweeping curve, 85 break, 77 control. None of his pitches have less than 70 control, and his walks over nine is 88. Again, nothing's going to overpower anybody, but you can just, again, pick corner, throw a low curveball, little cutter up under the hands to a righty. Just annoying. You can be an annoying pitcher. And one of the best strategies for hashtag team no money in Diamond Dynasty is become annoying on the mound. Be one of those guys. I know I got good contact on that. And when you really did.
Ooh, one of the things somebody mentioned from the last show, they like the tips about pitching in Fenway Park. If you have pitchers that you know aren't going to strike out guys, but are going to induce a lot of foul balls, let me recommend Dodger Stadium and what's Oakland? Just Coliseum?
O.co.
That's it.
Yeah.
I recommend those. Lots of foul territory, so you can get those first baseman and catchers over there to make plays.
Absolutely. The other ones, and this is going to sound strange because the miles above ground actually plays in the game. Coors Field has a huge outfield. And I think, what is it, Great American Ballpark, both really large outfields that you can possibly, if you get the ground ball guys. So you keep guys that have low home runs. Get nice high fly ball, or get nice high, like, you know, where it won't go out of the park.
According to Warrior 2K17 in the chat, he says it's not O.co anymore.
Oh, I believe that. Which also, is good because O.co shows up as a link in most Twitch chats, and then Nightbot says no. We found that out the hard way.
Interestingly enough, Ice Chili in the chat has actually mentioned your next choice.
Ice, you gotta let me pull the guys out first. He's got my book. That's what he's got. He's got the scouting report.
We're talking about Francisco Liriano for the Pirates.
Absolutely.
295/160.
All right, so Francisco Liriano, and this is not his flashback. This is actually his live series card. Is an 82 overall right now. What you like about this is his hits over 9 is a 78. His Ks over 9 is an 80. His home runs over 9 is a 73. His walks over 9 is a 47. This is not going to be a huge control guy for you. What this guy is going to do is you're not going to get good contact against him, and you're going to get a lot of strikeouts on his changeup slider. 92-mile-an-hour two-seamer, which, again, not great control. But his four-seamer is the secret. So his four-seamer has an 80-plus break on it. In this game, that tails. So you can throw inside four-seam fastballs to guys who are a little too patient and cut the corner. And then throw your changeup curve, changeup slider, which has a 95 break to it, by the way. Just for the strikeout. I haven't seen anyone that can actually hit Liriano's slider online yet. In just like low level team, again, hashtag team no money games.
So you're saying he's not like the rookie sale?
No, not rookie sale. He's not going to be, well, no, he's not unlike the rookie sale. Because
do we want to have this? Do we want to have the discussion right now?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, please.
Over rookie sale. I crush him all day long now. Everybody has him. He's become the new Pat Neshek for me. Everybody has him. So now I crush him all the time. I had Francisco Cervelli. Almost put one out of Minute Maid Park, like out of the whole place. It hit like the top brick on the way out. I was very upset.
I can absolutely see going into a game, like even batting practice offline and playing against the starting pitcher sale because they have the same motion. If you've gotten to the point where the motion doesn't bother you, because the rookie sale has high numbers with the exception of his walks over 9. So he's going to, if someone's using him, he's going to throw something in the middle of the plate to you at some point.
Yep.
Absolutely will, or he'll walk you. So you're saying that you've gotten so used to the motion, which was Neshek's big thing,
yep,
that it doesn't really matter. His pitches aren't great. It's fastball, two-seam slider, right?
Yes.
For the rookie sale.
I think so.
Hold on,
let me pull it up.
Go ahead. You got it? Go right ahead, please.
White Sox, flashbacks. It is four-seam slider, two-seam changeup.
So, yeah. So, I mean, it's, again, nothing crazy. I mean, I don't think his changeup's that great. So, and I know one of the questions we had coming this week is, would you rather have starting pitcher sale or relief pitcher sale on your team? Because you can only have one or the other. You can't have both.
I'd probably go starting pitcher sale, I think.
I think I do, too, because a better pitch mix, even though, again...
It's the same pitches, but it's just better.
Right. Just a better overall. I don't know. Because if now you're getting to the point where if people are getting used to that motion, is starting pitcher sale going to be... I know those ratings are too good. Never mind.
Yeah, his rating is legit. For the starting pitcher version, his rating is legit.
Yeah, so... Starting for whoever asked that question, starting pitcher sale over relief pitcher sale. And Francisco Liriano is essentially sale light.
Yeah.
With what he does.
I would say that. I would agree with that. Mm-hmm. My next pick is this is just for Paul right here. I'm going with Justin Verlander. You can get him right now for $330/$215. I like him. Nice even across the stats. Everything's between right around that 70 line. I like that.
Right.
I do love his pitch mix, though. Four-seam, circle change, slider, and 12-6 curve. Pretty much love everybody that has a 12-6 curve and the slider combo.
Yes, absolutely.
And I think he can still bring it with the fastball. Daddy Leagues has him at 93. That's kind of like the average, right? So I think he can get it up to 95 if you're like up and in.
Yeah, anything you see on Daddy Leagues in terms of fastball is his rating, his in-game rating, which means that you can pitch pretty much, I think it's 2 or 3 miles an hour over if you do max effort.
Yeah, so, I mean, and I feel like he's working on the comeback trail right now. Let me pull up his real stats. Justin Verlander. I want a way to tell Google that if I'm typing a baseball player's name, I want baseball references to first answer every time.
Yes, or just, you know how they have the, what is it, the button where you can just hit feeling lucky? Yes. It should just be feeling reference. Feeling baseball reference.
Feeling reference. Yep. Let's see. He threw a complete game for a loss. 7 innings for a loss. I mean, come on. I mean, he's not getting shelled. He's getting 8, 9 strikeouts.
Right.
He's doing good. I mean, he's pitching better than his record. His record's 2-4.
That I agree with.
But
again, the wins are gonna play a little bit in that too. So
yeah, I like him, but some others might not. 92 stamina, always nice to have.
Anything over 80 essentially is always great. Again, with Verlander, 92 is amazing. We talked about earlier the 89 stamina for Cliff Lee, same thing.
Next up for you, this dude played for the. I did not even know this guy played for this team.
Yes, the Athletics.
I mean, I know he plays for that team now. I did not. His jersey card is very confusing to me.
Yes, he's played for a lot of teams in the last couple of years.
I must have missed the memo that Rich Hill played for the Yankees, but he's now on the. Yes, Rich Hill.
He relieved for the Yankees. He relieved for the Red Sox. He's an Oriole for a cup of coffee.
He's on the. Chris Capuano train?
Yes, pretty much. Yeah, he's a lefty that can throw strikes, which immediately means you're going to have a longer career than any other pitcher.
Yep. And he also has the 12-6 slider combo that I like.
Yes, 12-6 is his main pitch, but it's not even his best off-speed pitch. His slider is far and away harder to hit than his 12-6 curve. His 12-6 curve I use as a setup pitch for the slider.
Now, are you throwing that 12-6 curve in the zone, or are you trying to throw it under and try to get?
I'm throwing the 12-6 curve for the most part. I'm catching side to side because the 12-6 can also have a scroogey look to it, mm-hmm. Screwball. So you throw it outside and it comes back. I will throw it out of the zone left and right, which is a little weird considering it should be, you know, something you go down with. But when you look at a 12-6 curveball coming across the body. It looks like it's going to hit every time. If you get the right spot, it looks like it's going to hit the edge of the strike zone every time.
I've been having the worst time trying to throw 12-6 curveballs with pitchers to their throwing side.
Okay.
It's like having a righty trying to throw it to the right side of the plate.
Right.
I don't know why. I just, for some reason, I can't hit the meter back that way. Obviously, you're playing on... You're playing with pulse, so that doesn't really matter to you. But
no, I'm using analog. I switched to analog like a week and a half ago. Couldn't believe it. It was a huge thing for me. Again, Scott Cole. I was watching Scott Cole play as his Road to the Show guy, and he was explaining why he used analog, and it just clicked in my head. I was like, you know what? He's absolutely right. I should be using analog pitching, and this helped me immensely, especially online.
It's not bad.
Yeah.
Please continue. Wrap up on Rich Hill.
The wrap up on the Rich Hill, the big thing is obviously 92 mile an hour curveball, 92 mile an hour fastball, and the 12-6 to 75 miles an hour. So, again, you're getting up to that 20 mile an hour chain differential in speeds.
I just wanted to take a quick second to answer a question from the chat. MK Hit Orion asks, how is Colin Ray? So let me just go flip over to him real quick.
Colin Ray. I had somebody use him against me in a Battle Royale game, and I could not touch him.
He's pretty good. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah.
Stats kind of suck, but 4-seam curveball, splitter, cutter, and 2-seam. So four fastballs and a curveball. But the fastball can get up to what, like 95?
Yeah.
Only problem is he has four pitches that are going to be right around 90 to 95. But then he drops that curveball at 81.
And online, when you're using, obviously playing against a computer's not going to drop 50% curveballs. But online, I mean, if you can get fastball, curveball working, and then feed the splitter two-seamer from there, I find the two-seamer a great pitch to get people to like ground into double plays with, or to you know break the bat, which mm-hmm. happens so often in this game. So
yeah, I try to bust that in with a righty. Try to bust it in on righties and try to snap that.
Yeah.
My next pick, we're going over to the Cardinals. We're going with Michael Wacha, 575, 350 right now. I don't know if I hate his windup or if I love it. I'm still trying to determine that. He's got a four-seam, a change, a cutter, and a curve. The fastball can probably get up to like 97, which is mm-hmm. very nice. And then he can drop a 75-mile-per-hour curveball on you, which is 20-mile-per-hour difference. Pretty nasty. I like to think of him as a mini Wainwright, almost. The Wainwright has the sinker, which is nice.
Right.
We touched on it in one of the earlier episodes. All the earlier episodes you can watch on youtube.com/thatsportsgamer. We have a whole two of them. We talked a little bit about how the pitch breaks can change. I was very upset when I saw that Adam Wainwright had a curveball and not his 12-6 curveball anymore.
Right.
But if you go in there and you play with him, his curveball is essentially a 12-6 curveball.
Yeah, exactly. And that's one of the things that I love about it is you'll see Wainwright, his tendency for his curveball is more, like you said, 12-6, 11-5. No, right-handed, other way around. So 1-7. So you get that. Whereas like Wacha, again, like you said, you get the difference in curve. And again, another small pro tip, if you don't get the curve you want, I wouldn't suggest doing this all the time, as it's annoying as hell. But if you're looking for a strikeout pitch and you want a curveball, you can hit L1 to step off. You will actually get a different curve when you come back on the mound.
When you started talking, I thought that was going to be it. And now I'm really excited to try that out.
Yes.
Because I feel like sometimes with I use that 91 flashback to Grom a lot. And sometimes I feel like his curveball doesn't get a good break. Or his slider doesn't get a good break. And I think I'm going to have to start stepping off a little more.
Yeah, you can step off, and like I said, when you come back and pick the same pitch, it will give you, because it's kind of random, kind of not, depending on what your break is, your break rating is on your pitch, but you will absolutely get a different different curve or different slide if mm-hmm. you hit a one.
Matt Foley says Wacha has a glitchy windup. I think that's why I can't tell if I love it or hate it.
Yeah, that's the thing, is that if you're pitching with him, it doesn't affect you because his windup, even though it's herky-jerky, like you don't have to herk and jerk the stick. Yeah. It just looks herky-jerky. It's not like Alex Cobb where you're taking a long time to pull the meter down and then a long time to ring it back up.
He's got a very smooth animation, a smooth meter. I guess what we say, a smooth meter. That sounds terrible, but.
He's a smooth criminal, right?
Sure.
No. One other thing, did you know this? And this is something I found out recently the other day. Did you know that you can use the meter as a three-click meter and not like a hold?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I wasn't aware of that.
Sometimes I accidentally double tap the pitch button.
Right. So I mean, for those of you that are using meter and might not like the slow windups because you're holding the button and letting go of it, you can actually use it as a three-click, like Tiger Woods' old system.
So I do it as a hold most of the time, just because. I think I've always used that.
Yeah, that's how I used it. That's how I've always used it. So,
lastly, then I will do a quick couple nominations. You've got Colin McHugh, who's currently going for 274, 140.
Yes. Love the McHugh for a couple of reasons. First of all, his 12-6 curve, we talked about that. Even though he's a four-pitch guy, and you try to go for a five-pitch guy most of the time, his 12-6 curve is 72 miles an hour off of a 91-mile-an-hour fastball, one of the best curveballs in the game with a 90 break, a 79 control. Again, I cannot stress how important it is to make sure that you have a high control rating on your curveball if you don't want to hang it, especially a 12-6 curveball. 12-6 curveballs that hang stay in the middle of the plate because most people like to use the 12-6 curve low and not to the sides. Yep. First of all, learn how to throw that pitch to the sides of the plate. Second of all, don't hang it. And the 79 control will help that. But again, everything else, 91 mile an hour fastball. Good cutter is his main pitch with good control on it. But you kind of want to stray away from it a little bit because the break's a little low on it. And his changeup is not going to strike hitters out. Even if you throw it low, it does not have the break. It looks almost, it just looks like a slow fastball. Use it as a pitch to contact pitch, not a strikeout pitch.
Yep. Last thing I wanted to mention was, if you go into these missions over here in the collect screen,
yes.
I'm going to have to scroll down here a little bit, right? They still show up here. Some guys I wanted to call out. You can do the raise 25 man and get an 85 overall Scott Kazmir starting pitcher. I think his main pitch is the sinker.
Two-seamer and a running fastball. He's one of the running few fastball. People in the game with the running fastball.
Yeah, I'm a huge fan of Scott Kazmir.
Yes.
A bit. Only problem, four-pitch pitcher. Not going to really get too mad about that. Also, not the greatest of speed differentiations. Only about 10 miles per hour there. Next up is the Angels 25-man set. I think all the ones that I'm about to recommend you can do for less than 1,000. Probably a lot less if you just go find super cheap guys.
Make some budget in my book.
Yep. Bartolo Colon, he's got a 92 fastball. 95 slider. 83 changeup and a 73 curveball. So that's going to be a nice change of pace.
And his fastball control is a huge thing, too. I mean, it's been a big thing for him now because he throws mostly fastballs. I think he has the number two percentage in the majors of fastballs thrown. 92 control on his fastball. Pick your spots, establish your fastball, learn how to pitch.
Then another lefty you can go out and get is Wandy Rodriguez from the Astros. 90 mile per hour fastball, 76 mile per hour curve. He also has a change, a slider, and a two seamer. Ooh, he's got 80 control on that curveball and 70
yes.
break.
Love the high control for off speed stuff.
That's a nasty put away pitch. And the last recommendation for me is going to be the Reds. Reds? Reds. There's an 83 overall Bronson Arroyo. I think his set was pretty cheap as well. Four seam, 12 to 6, change, slider, cut. As I said, I'm a huge fan of the 12 to 6 slider combo. And he's got great control over all his pitches. And one of those lineups that people are probably aren't going to like that much online if you do that.
One of the other guys, if you want to jump down to the Rockies, 25-man. I know we talked about him a little earlier. The Jorge De La Rosa is sitting at 90 stamina, 83 Ks over 9, 75 hits over 9. He's got a 93-mile-an-hour fastball and a 76-mile-an-hour curveball. Control is not great on anything. His break isn't great on any of his pitches, but his ratings combined with his speeds on his pitches and decent pitch mix, will make him very, very good for you, especially for hashtag Team No Money.
You got any other recommendations for some cheap starting pitchers?
No, I think that's pretty much it. I don't want to give out all the secrets, do we?
No, definitely not. Definitely not.
I do love that Kazmir. I can't put a stamp on that Kazmir enough. That Kazmir for me, I mean, you have to understand that he doesn't have a four seamer, but that Kazmir is amazing, amazing card.
Yep. Let me ask you a question. Do you want to start up your game and then I will,
we can
take some questions while you're playing?
Absolutely. Let's see what we have here. So what we're going to
do is the share thingy. And then
I know. I absolutely have to get you into my pote.
I don't want to party with you.
Come on, you know you want to party.
If you really want to party with me,
I knew that was coming. Now I got to leave a party, and I got to start the party and say, "If you really want to party, no, I'm gonna create a party. I got to make it private because you heathens will come in here and make bad words."
Yeah, we don't want you heathens.
Not that it matters, but
We also have some questions from last week that we didn't get to because we took forever in last week's show.
Go right ahead. Last week's show went over, but I will absolutely say that it was one of the best experiences in terms of talking baseball that I've ever had over this game. Just picking each other's brain. That's one of the reasons I think you and I both wanted to start this with each other is we both really know baseball. And but add Spore to the mix. Add it's at Sporer on Twitter. But add Paul Spore to that mix, and it was just really, really fun for that. So we're going to go over – you want a Battle Royale or you think you should do Diamond Dynasty? It's your call.
I mean, that's completely up to you. I would say why don't you get some of those budget starting pitchers in your rotation and then go play a game.
You know what? We can do that. What we're going to do then is we're going to do a head-to-head game. I think I actually have some of those. This is not a budget team. We should probably not show that one off.
Why don't you start the share play so that I can actually see?
Oh, you know what's probably a good idea.
This guy, folks. Working with amateurs over here.
What can I say? I'm so excited to show people what we're doing.
The first time I'm letting you actually play the game on the thing.
Play the game on the thing?
Usually I just play it.
No, I actually do not have my created player on my squad.
It's funny, with the way they've done those missions now, I haven't done anything to my creative player.
Really?
He has Cubs in him. He's got a bunch of Cubs in him right now. Other than that, that's it.
Tons of Cubs.
Because I'm going to need to feed him all these guys when I do those collections, right?
Let's see if we can find that. There's that Jorge De La Rosa I just talked about.
So you guys should be able to see his screen with no problem. Look, there's a Bartolo Colon.
I'm going to go ahead and pick
actually,
your...
Actually, why don't you put that Kazmir in there?
Yeah, the Kazmir's going in. We're going to go ahead and... So your Cliff Lee is in there. The Francisco Liriano. We're going to go lefty heavy. And where's my Bartolo? My Bartolo Colon. I need you.
People like lefties.
The best thing is a lot of teams you'll see will build their team up against righties because that's what you get the most of, and that's not what you should be doing. Make an even team.
Yep.
Coming Herrera, going to Raspo. And then
I feel like I've never gone to my bullpen and seen a green arrow.
I know. It's like terrible. Like, even like Craig Kimbrel down to a 90. Batances was like, as soon as he hit diamond, all he gets is low IEs. There you go. Brett Cecil up to an 81.
Shorb's got Ubaldo off of your recommendation last week, and he loves
Ubaldo. The 89 Ubaldo?
Yep.
Oh my god, that 89 Ubaldo. If you pull Nolan Arenado, I'm not gonna say that you should go out and buy Nolan Arenado, but if you pull Nolan Arenado, finish that collection. Absolutely finish that collection.
I'm also gonna recommend you hurry up and get to the game because you only have an hour time limit.
Yeah, I know. We're going to share play. Play. And we're going to do, you know what? We're going to do the Orioles because I love my Baltimore team.
Haven't been there in a while.
It's still a beautiful stadium. Went there yesterday.
Are we going to do this Philly thing?
We are doing this Philly thing. I already set the data part.
All right. Should I tweet at them and see if we can get some tickets? I mean, I don't know. Do I have pull like that with the Phillies?
Do you have that kind of sway with the Phillies? Are you tri-state? Is that what you are?
I mean, I never tweeted at him. I try to holler at him. You know be what like, what up?
You know the move is?
Put me in the nosebleeds. Me and my homies want to come.
Ramon to tweet at him.
Sure.
That's the move.
Sure.
So you see, even though this is a budget team, or budget rotation, 85, 85, 84, all still 80s. Guys you can get pretty easily. So we're just going to go ahead and play. Why not? Manny's at shortstop. Crystal, hold on. Wait a second there. Cal's going to shortstop so I can show him off to you guys.
Put Manny
and then third. There we go. Yeah, Manny at third. That left side of the infield, nothing. Nothing gets through that left side of the infield. So.
Oh, a couple things have changed on my team I would like to mention. Bert Blylevin out of the rotation. Gaylord Perry out of the rotation.
Yeah, I'm still using the Perry, but he's not long for my team.
I can't get his windup right at all.
It's not just the windup to me, it's the four-pitch thing. The four-pitch thing for both of them, I like to be able to mix up so much.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, excuse me. So, the Baltimore Pitches and Bows, guys, that is my team.
Hunter Pence on there?
Who's that? Hunter Pence, yeah. Hunter Pence getting a little Manny Machado love.
Yeah, especially with Blylevin, pretty cheap set to do, but he's got two curveballs, two fastballs. It's kind of pointless.
Yeah, it's like, and that's the thing is that you get the two curveballs. I'm okay with the two fastballs, but two curveballs being the only pitches to go off of, I mean, what are you gonna do, right? I do like this guy's jerseys a lot, the FSU jerseys.
So let's let me try to go through some
not
of these
a fan
questions
of pausing all the time
that we have here. I don't think they're actually pausing. I think they're looking at the like your pitch thing.
Yeah, no, I know. I just
figured that out like yesterday. Which is very frustrating.
And you see what we were talking about with the De La Rosa, the little leg kick there. Odorizzi has sort of the same thing.
Does it actually help with this pitching mechanic?
It really doesn't. Whoa.
Wow.
The cow just dropped that?
Cow just dropped that right off his face.
Oh, my Lord. Okay.
I think you should quick sell him.
Wow. Quick sell cow.
Get him off that team.
Now, here's the Yelich we talked about. This is the live series Yelich. You're not going to get me on that. It's not happening. I think I have Ortiz at first base. This is never good. I hit the square button. I shouldn't have.
All right, so we have some questions to go through, and then we can take some from the chat if they have anything in there.
Go for it.
Master Poppet on YouTube says, when you zone hit and you get the ball where you are looking for, do you power hit or just hit normally? And also, do you always contact hit on two strikes, or do you normal hit with a batter with good contact?
I always...
Dude, Cal is terrible. Not going to lie.
Yeah, no kidding. I always use my X button unless... So my decisions are made before the pitch. I always know if... Like, I'm 3-1 or 3-0, that's when I start looking at the power. And you know what we're going to have to do here? What I have to do every time somebody gets to second base. Just real quick. No. Although that's not going too far off the line here. I use fisheye camera normally as my batting camera, so now that I can so I can see Mookie Betts jumping around at second base.
I don't think I could do that switching between front and back.
Yeah, I like the broadcast cams. I absolutely love pitching from them. You can't look back online. So, and guys, I absolutely take advantage all the time. You jump off so far that you jump off so far at second base that anyone could steal. I'm not going to lie. David Ortiz at first base is not making me feel very good right now.
Good pitch. My answer for that question is I almost never use power swing. I feel like when I do, I just pop it up to the infield and I get very upset. And I also feel like I never really use contact hit. Maybe that's just me. I don't know. Maybe I'm crazy.
I use contact in 9-inning Diamond Dynasty games to extend the starting pitcher's pitch count.
You're right.
If I get down two strikes.
You know what? You're right. I'm a liar. If I have a terrible batter that I know is not going to get a hit,
right,
then I will use the contact swing to just try to like just foul off some balls. Like especially when I have pitchers up, I'll go contact swing just to try to foul stuff off and raise the pitch count up.
Right. So... just to kind of go with what's going on in my head right now, I know this Yordano Ventura just got dropped in ratings-wise. So I know that he's going to try fastball high and then that curveball, which has some speed as his off-speed stuff, and then change up low. You can already see it. He's starting with change up low and see the fastball high. So he's throwing me two fastball high, one curve, get me over curveball, and two change up low. So...
Healy 6 in the chat says he only uses power swing with players with over 90 power.
Actually, you know what? For me, this is going to sound weird. I think that's the reason not to use power swing. If you've got a guy with high power, use your contact swing and let that take over.
Sure.
So that for personal opinion, use your power swing on guys with like a 70 power. That. Again, but you have to know the pitch that's coming too. You have to like, okay, so it's 3-1. I'm getting a fastball. And then that's the other important part of this is don't use your power swing if you don't get the pitch you're expecting because you'll roll over it or you put it somewhere, you'll hit a ground ball, and your power swing is going to get wasted.
Yeah, it's almost impossible to check swing with power swing too.
Yes, absolutely.
Next up, Maya Mason to Tom on Twitter. A better set to complete, Cubs or Astros?
So the Cubs collection is Ooh, what is the Cubs collection? I'll tell you. I have it up.
I can pull it up.
The Cubs collection is Ryan Sandberg, second baseman.
Right.
Whereas,
not that great.
No, not really. And the Astros collection is Nolan Ryan. So your main, and I think I kind of typed this out. The difference is you look at the players that will be playing for your team after that collection is over. Obviously, the Nolan Ryan, it's Nolan Ryan versus Arrieta, so your choice on which one you think is better. You have Altuve versus Ryan Sandberg. You're going to have Carlos Gomez versus Jason Hayward. I'm trying to think about the other ones on this that were in that.
You're going to have Keuchel and Lester.
Yes. The big one is you also are going to have Rizzo with no one really to match up. Like, you get
Correa,
an extra card, you get a
really.
Yeah, Correa.
They would be the two that would be the closest.
Well, Correa and Chris Bryant, though.
Well, who'd you just say?
You get Rizzo.
Oh, right. Okay, Rizzo.
So you have Correa and Chris Bryant both are going to probably go up in ratings as the year goes on. Yeah. The Astros don't have like a Rizzo that go up with it. Now, you're going to pay more. I think it's like 20,000 more stubs
to
finish the Cubs.
Yeah, when we looked at it, it was like 10 to 20,000 more to do the Cubs.
Right. But 10 to 20,000 and you're going to get Rizzo, where everything else is kind of even with the exception of, I think Altuve is much better than Sandberg.
Yeah, that Sandberg is not even that great of a card.
Right, exactly. So, but the Rizzo is. So you're kind of comparing Rizzo versus Altuve and Sandberg versus, Sandberg's the extra card, I would think, at that point.
Yeah, so I don't know. It's tough because I like the, I think I would have to go Astros. Because you're going to solidify the middle of your infield with Altuve and Correa. And you're going to get that ace Nolan Ryan. Keuchel's nice. George Springer's nice. Granted, there's a lot of gold that you're getting with the Cubs. And Rizzo's a beast. But I feel like you're really getting Arrieta and Rizzo. Because I feel like Ryan Sandberg's just not going to play for you.
Yeah. It's at some point, like you see, I have the 89 Aaron Hill in right. Not a lot of people are going to use simply because he's the Toronto, collection, which is like Batista and all kinds of gold and diamonds, unfortunately. But who is the other second baseman? Oh, the Pedroia. You can get the Pedroia, who is better than the Sandberg, right? The normal live series Pedroia, better than the Sandberg right now.
Yeah. I mean, you can also get a D. Gordon, and you can get a guy with speed. There's a lot of things you can do at second base. And I felt like that Ryan Sandberg just not that great a card. I think it had like 50s and 60s for contact and power.
Yeah, he's got good speed. And obviously he's going to have good clutch and good vision. Just that's what most of the legends have. But really nothing past that.
Next up, that Zach Davis on Twitter says, what am I going to use stubs on in franchise?
Ooh, here we go. So you can do one of two things. Well, actually, no, you can't really use the equipment. Actually, so one of two things.
You can pretty much use your sponsorships, and that's pretty much it, right?
Sponsorships, but also you can use the franchise budget. You can buy budget with stubs.
Ah, true.
So I think it was $4 million in budget for 1,000 stubs and like $48 million for like 20,000 stubs, something like that. So you can definitely use that if you're looking for extra budget during free agent time.
Mm-hmm. You can use that. Yeah, Zach does not play Diamond Dynasty or anything. I don't think he even plays Road to the Show, so he's not even going to buy the equipment stuff.
A ton of people don't. A ton of people are offline gamers. I mean, I have two franchises going right now. I have a Rockies franchise that we do on stream, and I have an Orioles franchise that I just do by myself. That four-seam fastball is not getting by me up high. It's just not going
to
happen.
Steel Town in the chat wants to know how much it costs to complete the Cub set. If you don't have any of the cards, the average cost to complete the set is 130,000 stubs.
Yeah, I would say pretty much unless you're looking like to spend some money, I would only complete collections that you pull a major card for.
Yeah. And I would even say maybe don't do the set. Just get Rizzo and Arrieta and then move along.
Move on.
Yeah. Maybe that Hayward could be nice.
The Hayward card, the arm in right field, and I think he's pretty good contact-wise all around. So,
but actually, that Fowler card just got a bump, too, which is nice. He's pretty nice to play with right now.
If he keeps hitting like the way he is, too. So. Good investment card.
Yep.
All right, so curveball low, fastball high. I get it.
Augman97 on Twitter asks, of course, I just erased the thing. Do you know how to unlock any of the discovery missions in Diamond Dynasty?
There were some we looked into. I know the hit blast from the past is 500 hits with flashback players.
Yep. And then the rest of them, you need to get the rookie flashback version of some guys. Trying to see which ones they were.
There's a Howie Kendrick, I know. Let's see here.
Yeah, I had the list somewhere.
Alex Gordon, Alex Rios, CJ Wilson, Jay Bruce,
Jimmy Rollins, John Lackey, Mark Burley, Matt Cain, R.A. Dickey, Ryan Howard, Yadier Molina, Ryan Zimmerman, and Howie Kendrick.
There you go.
So I guess when you get that card, the missions show up. Is that how that works? I still have not seen these cards.
No. Actually, the missions don't show up until you get what the first thing of that mission is. So, like, the Yadier Molina,
you have 40 hits, but you don't know that.
Right. You don't know that until you actually start getting hits with Molina.
Ugh. I don't like that at all.
This last defensive play you see that Jackson just made, I've learned that a lot of people having problems with fly balls, like, getting by them, and they think they're under them. You got to remember that this game, the defense in this game is animation-based, much like NBA 2K is. You have to know that you have to trigger an animation. So if you are going back on a ball and you are not getting animation, slow down. Slow down, start feathering the stick, and start jogging to the spot so you can get an animation. Don't run as fast as you can right to the spot. Expect to be able to stop to the spot while the ball is almost on top of you and go from there. So, whoa, the bat just went kind of levitation in the middle of the air there.
Next question is one we talked about earlier from Buckeye Britain on Twitter. Relief pitcher sale or starting pitcher sale? Leaning towards SP, but I don't know who to put in the bullpen to replace him.
Jake Diekman is a good budget lefty. I think we've talked about before.
Yep. I mean, if you have the coins to spend, because I know that sale, I think you can buy him for a couple grand. I would highly recommend getting either, if you want to go with the gold, go with Zach Britton. Right?
Zach Britton? Zach Britton is filthy. Absolutely filthy.
Yeah, and I also like the Glenn Perkins. But again, these guys, I feel like they're always on negatives, which is kind of a pain. But for the starting pitcher, he's at 94 right now. Then in real life, he's 8-0 with a 1.67 ERA and a 0.758 whip. So he's probably going to get in a bump soon. So go out there and get him. I think he's pretty pricey.
You mean whip?
Whip.
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 No. It's whip.
Yeah, whip.
No, you're saying the H. It's whip, right? No,
yeah,
just whip.
Whip. Whip.
Right. That's no. It's just whip. Say whip.
Whip.
All right, I can't keep going with this bit. Right. It's funny as hell. I can't keep going with it.
All right.
Family Guy bits. Love it.
Next up, I got Dennis Darren 95 on Twitter asking, which diamond starter do you recommend the most? He already has Thor. Also, my answer now changes because of that two-second conversation about Chris Sale we just had. I say Chris Sale now.
He's getting a bump. Hold on, give me a minute. I had them all up here a second ago. I do like the Sale a lot. I'm pretty much gonna stick with Sale. I do like the Max Scherzer from the Nationals. I know you had that on a list that I saw too.
Yep.
But that being said, I really like his pitch mix and the abilities he has. He's gonna get a bump too at some point. So.
Yeah, he's got it. Gotta go.
Oh, terrible swing. What am I swinging at?
And then I also, when the person tweeted, I said Scherzer back to him. Also recommended getting in on Steven Strasburg. Not a diamond yet.
Will
be soon.
Yeah, will be.
What's going on, Buff 8824 in the chat? How's it going?
Oh, what's going on, Brett? That is one of the guys from OS.
Ah.
That stops in our stream a lot.
Oz. Does he have a OS on the end of his Twitter handle?
No, he does not.
All right. We had a couple people send in their teams they wanted us to take a look at.
Oh, I would love to take a look at some teams.
I mean, it's going to be a little hard for you because you can't really see it, but...
Yeah, exactly.
first one up, we have... this is Mudhead78, a.k.a. C. Blake in the chat. He has Carl Crawford in left, Jeff Francoeur in right, Ryan Braun... I don't know how he does this. He's got Carl Crawford, Braun, and Francoeur in the outfield, the flashback Francoeur. Then he's got...
That's right, keep trying to bunt.
Then around the infield, he's got Eddie Matthews, J.J. Hardy, your best friend. There's a flashback Ben Zobrist, I guess. That's a 94. Flashback Prince Fielder, who's a 96. And Brian McCann behind the plate. I know he had an extra outfielder, and he wanted to know who to get rid of, and I told him to get rid of someone. But anything you can think of? I mean, that's a pretty stacked team. I don't really know if I would get rid of
Yeah, them. I mean, at that point, what I would say to anyone at that point is start grinding your embody missions and your feed missions.
Mm-hmm.
The best players you're going to get that aren't for like the AL East collection or the AL Central collection, the best guys you're going to get are going to come out of those embody missions.
Yeah. Yeah. So. He also had Hunter Pence, and I told him if he's not going to do the Giant set, just get rid of him.
You see what I'm doing here, by the way? And again, big Jose Abreu, Jorge De La Rosa just picking corners. I mean, like, it doesn't even have to be off the plate. Just don't ever throw anything in the middle of the plate. Even most guys won't even walk. So the other thing, too, that I wanted to point out, and I was using this against – he was doing trying to bunt cheese me. If you think a bunt's coming, throw it out of the zone.
True.
Most guys that put the sacrifice, there's two bunts, obviously, sacrifice and drag. Most guys that are trying to bunt cheese you won't pull the bunt back. Like, they don't have that kind of discipline. And for the most part, if it's out of the zone, number one, they're either going to bunt it foul or they're just going to get a strike against them. Mm-hmm. So, pitching out of the zone, something that's just undervalued in this game.
Who's your favorite catcher in this game?
Yogi Berra.
Okay.
With that question. So I had this question. I had a guy pull Buster Posey and ask me this earlier this week, I think. No, last week. Pulled Buster Posey and said, what should I do? I said, Buster Posey, probably the best catcher in the game, not named Yadier Molina flashback. That being said, Buster Posey is high contact and his arm strength is like a low 70s, I think. I told him, grind the Yankees. Get your Yogi Berra. I keep swinging to that high fastball.
You could probably sell that Posey and get all the Yankees.
Yeah, you're going to sell them. Well, you don't even have to collect the Yankees. That's the best part.
But I mean,
you could literally
if you're going to grind them, you're going to want to get those guys. But you're going to be you're going to have way more than
one. Well, you can grind them against the computer. As crazy as that sounds, you can do play versus CPU, and just put the lowest steady Yankees as you want down there. So. I mean, if you really want to do it that way.
I mean, that sounds the opposite of fun. So.
Team No Money. Team No Money is about the grind. You know that.
No, I don't know that. I don't know what this Team No Money is.
Team No Money. I mean, not here, but I mean, I've been Team No Money in a couple Ultimate Teams. You got it's like why the journeys in Madden Ultimate Team are so important.
True. I do need to catch up on some of those. CSU Rams 97 in the chat asks, howdy, kind sir. Would you have a relief pitcher with no fastball?
If they had one in the game, yeah, obviously. Absolutely. I'm a huge junk ball guy. I
wanna
love
say,
junk ballers.
Does Nishik have a fastball?
Yeah, he's got at least a two-seamer. I mean, I guess the sinker technically counts, too,
I mean,
if you want to go there.
Well, I mean, if you want to just throw them, we're throwing cutters and everything. I'm assuming he means a four-seam fastball.
A reliever without a four-seam fastball, yeah, without question.
Pat Nishik has no fastball. He's got a slider, a sinker, and a circle change. So, yes, his sinker is a fastball, but... and his... he's got 99 control on the sinker. It's pretty nasty. 91 break on the slider. 86 break on the change.
Oh, hi, Cal. How you doing?
Yeah, I think I'm definitely going to play this. Start playing this Nishik. But yeah, he's got 90 mile per hour sinker and 70 mile per hour changeup. They should make that changeup a little bit slower, and it'll be a little more.
Yeah, well, and that's the thing. When you get a guy that doesn't have a true like heater, like you're not look at a guy that has like a 90 mile an hour fastball. What you're looking to do is pick spots, pick the corners, pitch off the plate. Guys love to swing away in this game. You got to realize that you have to be willing to walk a guy when you don't have a heater. So,
yeah,
that's the definition of junk baller.
And the best part is, those guys have pitches that are going to make people put it on the ground, which is going to turn those walks into double plays.
As a heads up, I just tried that. The L1, the pickoff or the pitch or leadoff now works without having to tap it twice.
Yeah, they just put that out in the new patch, which we didn't talk about, which we were supposed to talk about.
It's okay.
But listen, we're still working on Mudhead 78's team, a.k.a. Okay. C. Blake. His starting rotation is flashback to Grom, 88 Archer, 85 Taiwan Walker, 95 Kazmir, 94 Tyson Ross. Spent a lot of time in his offense, not a ton of time on his starting pitching.
I'm trying to think about... Maybe get yourself one of the legend pitchers. Work your way towards like the Seaver for Cincinnati, maybe, or is it Cincinnati that does the Embody? I'm trying to think. I think it is. I think it is Seaver.
Yeah, I believe it's the Seaver.
Oh, that's gonna go on. Oh, that should have been out of the park.
I would also say Hall right a Thor if you can afford him. If you can't, yeah. Scherzer,
Kluber. The Kluber that's on the Captain Store.
Yeah, and Strasburg.
Yeah, Strasburg definitely. Depending on what you're looking at, Stubbs wise. Wow, nice.
And then I also want to take a look at Celtics fans' team real quick. I believe he said he had 35K to mess with. I'm gonna say 35K. He has 32,000 stubs. Okay.
32. Okay. By the way, for every team that has a catcher not named Barra, grind and get Barra, period. That's number one advice for me.
Is it good advice? Questionable. If you don't have the time, go get yourself do the 25-man collection for the Red Sox. Get yourself Jared Saltalamacchia. Slap it down the third baseline every time. Get a double and be happy.
Yeah, that's again one of those pro tips. You get a guy that has extreme right on him. A lot of the power lefties.
Yeah, you know who else has the extreme right? Francisco Cervelli.
Even though he's a right-handed batter, yeah.
So I pull it all the time with him, and I love it.
Well, that's why I use manual shifts.
That's why I have to put that. I have to put that home run hit off that sail because it was ridiculous. It was such a blast. So listen, this is Celtics fans rotation. We got Strasburg, flashback Latos, Masahiro Tanaka, flashback Bartolo, the rookie flashback, and Garrett Richards.
What was the first one?
Strasburg.
Go ahead and get yourself. I love Garrett Richards, by the way. We talked about him earlier. But if you're going to upgrade your team, get yourself a high-end lefty to throw into that rotation. Maybe a Hamels, maybe a... We talked about Keuchel earlier.
Hamels, definitely not a... Oh, Cole Hamels. I was thinking...
Cole Hamels, yeah. Jason... You were thinking Jason Hamel?
Yeah.
Maybe? No. Cole Hamels, like his pitch mix a lot. Dallas Keuchel is another good one. Good. Like that. See what I was talking about? Not being able to bunt. So now I'm going to start pulling it back.
I just want to see. Oh, I wish. Can we get Daddy Leaks to do lefties? Lefty versus righties?
That'd be nice. So. I don't think so, yeah. Unfortunately.
You can get Lester for like $7,000.
Oh, I like Lester a lot, actually.
Yeah, Hamels is a little bit more. Keuchel's is going to be $5,500 ballpark. Also, if... Unless you have some need of... You need the card right now. Never just buy the card. Always put out a buy order for like five more than the one out there.
Yeah, never put out a buy. And always remember you can buy from theshownation.com. You can always check that on your, if you go to theshownation.com, you can go into, log in your PSN. You can buy from there. You can buy orders in from there. A lot of the time during the day, prices fluctuate greatly. Mm-hmm. You can play the market very easily.
Yeah, and it works on your phone as well.
There you go.
Yeah, I agree with you. I'm gonna high agree fastball. With your lefty recommendation because he does not have any. He says Lester sounds good to him. I like that.
I do like Lester a lot. I agree with that. I said Keuchel and Hamels. Lester is amazing.
Yeah, they're all three of those guys are great options. To his infield, he's got LaCroix, Miggy, Cano, Chris Bryant, Xander Bogaerts. Listen to this. Xander Bogaerts is an 87.
Apparently, Xander Bogaerts
is good. I missed it in an upgrade at some point. Yeah, that Xander Bogaerts is legit. I might start putting him in over Corey Seager.
And look at his defense numbers. His defensive numbers hold up at shortstop.
Yep. And a quality arm. I also use the Chris Bryant. I like the Cano. I would say maybe upgrade the catcher a little bit. Who could we get for like a little bit? Also in the chat they asked about Raleigh Fingers while we're looking for this catcher. I'm gonna say pass on Raleigh Fingers unless you loved Dennis Eckersley last year.
Yeah, I don't think Raleigh, what's he, a three-pitch guy?
I think he's two-seam. You know what? I might as well just look it up, right? Give me 1 second. How'd you get your 2 runs? Because I haven't been watching.
Called high fastball to Carl Crawford and hit it to the opposite power alley. Like, literally said high fastball. That's why I said it. And hit it. It's good. And then I hit Aaron Hill, who's my clutchiest of clutch. I will never tell anybody to get that card, the 89 Aaron Hill, but he has had the biggest hits for me in Diamond Dynasty so far. If you complete the Toronto collection, that Aaron Hill is a great card.
Raleigh Fingers has a sinker, slider, or four seam.
Oof.
And they're all in the same ballpark. The slider is 86, fastball is 92.
I don't know about that.
I mean, if you liked the Eckersley last year, the Raleigh Fingers is essentially the same card.
Right. Yeah.
Also, my catcher recommendation, Brian McCann's about 6,500 stubs. You can probably get him for. Anybody other than that is going to be, you're going to want to do something for because they're all going to be super, like Buster Posey's going to be 60,000, probably 55, 60,000 subs, so we're not there. Flashback McCann's going to be 60,000 subs, so we're not there. Flashback Ruiz is going to be 35 to 40,000 subs, so we're not there. I would probably say go with the McCann for now.
And but the McCann's going to plus arm.
I also don't like the McCann that much. I feel like he doesn't have these great hitting stats.
Yeah, and what's weird is I think he hits lefties better than he hits righties.
Let me see. Hold on, let me just see who he's got on his bench. He's got Soltamaki on the bench. Let me tell you something. He's doing something right now that I really like. This is something I do with my team, sometimes with LaCroix, but more times with, I think it's Yadier or Russell Martin. He's got the LaCroix, and then he's also got the flashback Soltamaki that you get from the from that red set. Yep. I think that's a good combo.
I love that. LaCroix is a good defensive catcher. Good arm. Can contact both sides. So if you've got Salty in against a righty, which is going to be probably 70% of the time, you've got a good defensive, good contact pinch hitter coming up.
The only problem with Soltamaquia is I now cannot throw him curveballs low, like in the dirt, and be have any confidence in him.
Yeah, one thing that underrated is blocking. Definitely want to check your blocking ratings.
Yeah.
For catchers. I think LaCroix is not bad on that. I think he's still 70s.
Yeah. I would definitely say you can get the McCann, which is a nice card. It's not like great or anything.
Right.
It's got like 52. His contact is 52-67, and his power is 79-73, which is nice. Don't get me wrong. For like 6,500, 7,000, I might say just stick with Salty and LaCroix for now.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you're looking for that, I wouldn't waste it on McCann because, again, I think LaCroix is probably even, if not a little better than McCann, even though McCann's a gold. McCann's better defensively, but you can deal with LaCroix and you can deal with Salty. So
yeah, and Salty's got, 88 power versus righty.
Yeah.
McCann's only got 79.
Rakes righties. Absolutely rakes righties.
And then...
No, doing the same thing I tell everyone not to do. Be patient.
Yeah, look. If you play...
Not a fan of Wieters. Wieters has got a Novak. Wieters just got a huge downgrade to where he used to be able to hit. He used to be the anti-Salty. He could hit lefties, but he just got a downgrade not too long ago.
Yeah, so if you look at this, Salty's got 80 contact versus righties. LaCroix's got 75 contact versus righties. McCann's got 52. And then versus lefties, Salty sucks. He's got a 35. LaCroix's 81. That's great. McCann, 67. Yeah. Solomaki's got 88 contact versus righties. McCann's behind there with 79. LaCroix's back there with 51. Obviously. So you're gonna start Solomaki against righties. The only problem is power versus lefties is where you lose out on. That's the only of these three guys, that's the only real thing.
Right.
Because McCann's got 73 power versus lefties. I don't even think the other guys combined for 73 power against lefties.
Yeah, no, I mean, like I said, McCann is, funny enough, is a better hitter against lefties than he is against righties in this game. So, I mean, real life splits are that way too, so.
Yeah, so I would almost stick with, I would probably stick with the platoon over getting him.
Okay. Well, I think I've given a pretty good case for the Jorge De La Rosa so far. I think 5 hits, no runs over 6 1/3.
Actually, so, you know, you might want to take a look at, I might go crazy and say swap out Yasmani Grandal for the weak side platoon with Salt Lamakia. Because he's got 78 like contact versus lefties, and he's got 81 power versus lefties.
So yeah, you had to sell me on the Grandal. I do like it now. Yeah. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, I like that he's a switch hitter, and then you would think he would be better as a lefty, because most switch hitters are better lefty switch hitters.
Right.
But no, he's better righty. So,
all right, let's see who we have warming up in the pen. It might be time. Look at Koji. I'm going to do this. I'm doing it right now.
Bullpen. You want to take a look at his bullpen? He's got Flashback Axford, Rondon, Nishik, Flashback Sale, Hunter Strickland, Kelvin Herrera, Darren O'Day, and Dylan Betances. I like that bullpen. I have no problems with that.
I don't have any problem with that. I like the Betances a lot, obviously. I'd say
throw in a Zach Britton. Get another lefty in there.
Yeah, Zach Britton. You might be able to get Jake McGee on the cheap because he just got downgraded from the Rockies.
You can probably get the... let's just say he gets the Lester. And that costs him, what, 6 of the 30? He's got 20-something to play with. I would say maybe even go and get a Chapman. Chapman might be getting a bump. Because what's he, 88, 89?
Yeah. 90? No, he's a 90. He's like a 91, I think.
So I might say get a Chapman over a Britton. Or get a Chapman. I mean, what's the Yankee set?
The Yankee set for the 25-man?
No, for the 40 or the full.
40-man is Reggie Jackson.
I would... Oh, we also didn't look at his outfield, but I would almost say you have Betances. You could probably get, I mean, depending on who else you have, you might be able to get Miller and Chapman with the change that you have left. And then you'd be pretty close to getting that whole Yankee set. And then you sell some of these guys that you have left over from this, get that Reggie Jackson. I mean, his outfield is stacked right now. Reggie Jackson never hurts an outfield. He's got Flashback, Matt Holliday.
Oh, is this the? And then this is the gold, legend Zobrist, I think.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Yeah. He's not going to beat me against Andrew Miller. Sorry to cut you off, Ken.
He's got Matt Holliday, Lorenzo Cain, and Carlos Gonzalez in the outfield, and it's Flashback Matt Holliday. So I would say go do the Yankee set.
Yeah.
And then you can throw Reggie Jackson out there. And then you could sell one of those guys if you didn't want to do their sets.
Right. No, absolutely. I think you're absolutely spot on.
Is the Reggie Jackson a center fielder?
The Reggie Jackson is a center fielder, yes. Actually, no, I think he's a right fielder who just got put in center of my game. And there's Joe. You want to see what Reggie Jackson does?
That ball put in the street. Off the building. Off a bounce. How hilarious would it have been if I was not actually on your game screen this whole time? So funny. Yeah, Healy 6 says Cervelli is pretty good. I also like Cervelli.
Cervelli, the nice thing about Cervelli is, so Cervelli is like, again, for people that use auto shift, has that sneaky good, the sneaky good in terms of the opposite shift for some reason. So,
yeah. I think
right that's... I'm contact swinging, by the way. Yeah, you can see my, forget the zone, what the zone looks like, but we're on two strikes, so contact swing just to wait for me to get a good pitch here.
Thanks for coming out, CSU Rams. We really appreciate it.
Yeah.
If you guys have any feedback for the show, as you can tell, we're still in the infancy of the show. Mondays at 10 p.m. right here on twitch.tv/ThatSportsGamer. We would love to hear your feedback. You can drop that to us on Twitter, at ThatSportsGamer, or at MillenniumOS. I also have feedback at ThatSportsGamer.com if you want to shoot an email. When this goes up on YouTube, you can also leave a comment in the comment section there.
Oh, nice slider. Oh, I wanted that one so bad.
You're going to come whiff with Chris Davis and his zero vision?
Yep. Show you why you don't get a Chris Davis.
Oh,
no, it's not. It's foul. It was just early of it.
Just a little bit.
Yeah, look at that zone, though. The zone was right on. High fastball. Oh, I want it. I thought he was going high on me. All kinds of curves. Wait a second. Hold on. Who is he throwing curves with? Oh, Tozawa. Hey, Tozawa ain't got no curveball. I was stupid for even thinking that. Or fastball, I didn't even think of that.
I feel like this show is going much faster in a good way.
Yeah. Yeah. You know what the problem was?
Getting that Sporer guy in here talking all the time.
I got to get that Sporer guy talking baseball to us.
Get him out of here. Yeah, and so if you guys have questions, you can also send them to us on Twitter. We'll also answer them on Twitter, but then we'll also bring them into the show. Because usually the way it is, if one person has a question, many people have a question and they just don't answer it. Or they just don't ask it.
Absolutely. Yeah, definitely ask questions. We love, like, one of the things that you and I both do that a lot of streamers don't, very interactive, like talking to the chat. I mean, talk to us. That's what we want to do. That's what we love doing. We love answering questions. Talking baseball.
Like a lot. Like a lot. Yeah, love, a lot. Questionable. Like it a lot.
I love it. I love it. One of the reasons I got into streaming was just the interaction is just fun for me.
Until you start playing, amazing. Then it's
trust me. One of the problems that I have with streaming is it's very, very hard to focus.
I'm surprised you're actually winning this game right now.
Nah, I'm good.
Is it Mookie Betts?
Yeah, Mookie Betts.
Straight up, only knew it off the batting stance.
I don't know why in the world he would look at that curveball. I hung that thing right in the happy spot.
Yeah, so as I said, we do the show every Monday, 10 p.m. Eastern. Next week we'll have JO30 on. I guess I should double-check my thing with him to make sure he's on.
You're going to avenge?
I'm going to whoop him.
Yeah, that's what I want to talk about. That's what I want to see. I want to see a win. I want an official win. Over JL.
Novak gets the game on Thursday. Won't have PSN or BR. Won't have PSN for BR or head-to-head. Any start recommendation? How do I start
Conquest? Well, here's what I would say. So it depends on whether you want to do dynamic difficulty or if you want to do just regular difficulty. What I would suggest is
dynamic difficulty no matter what.
Yeah. Well, that's what I did. But for Road to the Show... Road of the Show is a perfect way to get your dynamic difficulty up because it allows you to enjoy the game while you're in double A. You can kind of feel like you're an actual top prospect while your dynamic difficulty is raising. And then, like, right now, my dynamic difficulty is in Hall of Fame Plus because I was doing well as a prospect. So.
And now you suck.
Now I'm terrible. Oh, it's gotten so... It's not tedious. It's just you have to be very, very patient on those levels because they will just constantly pitch edge of the plate, edge of the plate, edge of the plate.
And they have no problem walking you.
Oh, no. Well, that's what I love about the level is that if you want to find a way to really get your eye trained for online, go into a Hall of Fame level play now game just against the computer and play for three innings. They will pitch around you, and you will absolutely not be able to just sit there and swing at everything like I've been doing this game.
He meant DDYs. Well, if he doesn't have PSN, he can't connect to Diamond Dynasty, right?
Yeah, no, there's no, you can't do Conquest, you can't do anything Diamond Dynasty wise unless you have an online connection.
But even if you,
I mean, you can just start playing regular games and get your captain level up, and you'll start earning stubs. The game, if you're offline, the game will save that until it connects to the server. So.
But if you don't have PS Plus.
PS Plus? No, you'll still get, I mean, eventually you want to get PS Plus. Right? Yeah, you'll still get the stubs. You'll still get the captain's store experience.
You get the rewards. So,
I think you still get the rewards. Yeah, I still think you get the rewards. Who's on the mound for me? Is it still Betances? Yeah, you know what? Betances is staying in. Because he doesn't want anything. That, about what? Betances? Would you rather have Kimbrel?
You don't need PSN for Conquest. Interesting.
No. You're still connected. That's fine. You can't play other users online. That's what the thing is.
Interesting. Sure about that? Matt Foley says this, so I believe it.
Yeah, you can play. Yeah, you can play Diamond Dynasty modes. You can't play against other users.
I mean, I'll take what you guys say.
Oh, you don't like that knuckle curve, do you, buddy?
That's pretty nasty.
Cyclops 7 does not like the knuckle curve. Best nice. Pitches in the Oof. Game. Ah, nice swing. Wow.
Don't you miss when the ball used to bounce off the pitcher? You've been cool right there.
Well, that was the hit before that. The ball hit bounce off the pitcher. All right, Jose. It's time. You wanted it. You got it. Put in the game. Want yourself a little Craig Kimbrel? He's got a knuckle curve too, by the way.
Thankfully, I don't think I've let my ridiculous coughing get onto the stream too much tonight. I'm very excited about that.
No, I haven't heard you cough once.
There's one more thing we wanted to talk about. I'm going to pull up the thing that you wouldn't put a link to.
What did I do?
There we go. I guess we should talk about the patch real quick before we wrap up this game and we wrap up this show. They fixed the thing with cloud saves. Cloud saves should now work.
Yes. Cloud saves, everything. There have been problems with people saving it and trying to move between systems and stuff, and it should now work.
I have a real big problem with cloud saves. Let me tell you what it is. They didn't make a video version of this game last year, so why the hell am I going to use a cloud save?
That's a very good point. Some people use multiple PS4s. Some people are transferring over.
You going to blow this or what?
No.
No, he blew it.
Throw this guy out third, yep.
Or you can throw him out at first. He didn't tag up.
Don't have to worry. No, didn't have to worry about it. Wanted to make sure he knew that I had the arm.
It would have been nice if you did actually play that, though. Fixed classic base running, which we noticed. Right? That's the L thing that we were talking
about? Yeah, that was a huge thing in 104 that got messed up. Mostly for offline gamers. There is still some issue with that I've already seen come up with holding L1 for advance all. The best thing I can tell you, online specifically, not offline, the best thing I can tell you if you're an online gamer or a Diamond Dynasty gamer is learn how to manual base run with everybody. Like, point to the guy, learn how to get them to do what you want them to do when you want them to do it.
I mean, I only learned how to manually base run last year.
Well, there you go.
How sad is that? Great game. Great win. Way to edge that out. I think that's going to do it for the show. Thank you, everybody that came out and watched. We appreciate it. As I said, every Monday, 10 p.m. Eastern, we'll be here talking MLB The Show. You can follow me on Twitter at ThatSportsGamer. Hit me up on YouTube.com/ThatSportsGamer. Hit that follow button over here on Twitch. I'd appreciate that very much. Millennium, where can I follow you?
You can follow me on Twitter at MillenniumOS, two L's, two N's. You can also follow my Twitch, which is not just MLB The Show, but obviously NBA 2K16 and a few other sports games. It's twitch.tv Operation Sports.
What else? I don't know. That's pretty much it.
That's it, yep.
Again, if you guys have questions, you can send us them on Twitter. Or you can leave them in the comments when we put the video up on YouTube. Or, again, feedback at thatsportsgamer.com. You can also do that. Thanks for watching, folks. We'll see you again next week.
Next week, 10 o'clock, guys.
Now, I see how we're in the bullpen. I see a gentleman from way over there. He's tapping his arm. He wants us to get out of the bullpen and get into the game.
We're on our way in.
We get one of those cool little cars. It'll look like a baseball. It'll be awesome.
Oh, the Lee Smith car. The bullpen car. It's what I want.
Yep. All right. See you guys.
See you guys.